My name's Don, and I'm going to be the moderator this evening.
Marcos Munoz
was actually an original member of the United Farm Workers in Delano, California in 1965. And he also was one of the original organizers of the grape boycott at that time. This, of course, is our May Day program. We're going to be talking about... he's going to be talking about Cesar Chavez, the United Farm Workers, and the campaigns by the United Farm Workers.
A warm round of applause for our speaker, Marcos Munoz. Come on down.
Good afternoon. My name is Marcos Munoz. I'm one of the fishermen farm workers. We come out in Delano, California in 1965. But before I get into the little story about the farm workers, I'd like to introduce myself when I come to this country. I come to this country at the age of 13. I don't know how many of you people know Mexico. A lot of places in the Mexican border special, it's a real kind of hard life. We depend on a lot of the tourists to go from Texas to Mexico and get drunk and do a lot of things they don't do over here, you know, abuse the system.
I've been through that.
And some of that, when you see that these people are abusing other person, you don't feel it. But when it comes into your own family, then you do feel it. To make the long story short, I had a sister that was a victim of these American soldiers going into Mexico and spend the American dollars and, you know.
It's Nick, David.
And I was embarrassed. And I ran for Ciudad Acuña, Coahuila, which is a border town from the Rio Texas. And as I came in the United States, in Texas. Finally, one lady gave me a job because she felt sorry for me. I was 13, I'm short, no papers. She paid me $2 a day. And my job was to clean the corral, pick up the eggs of the chicken, and feed the pigs, and do whatever they need to tell me how to do. $2 a day, maybe it was not too much. But it was more than what I had. I worked for the lady maybe about 2 or 3 months, and then one relative of that lady offered me another job for $3 a day between Houston and Galveston. So they took me up there, and they put me in the trunk of the car so that way the immigration won't see me, you know? So I didn't know which way they took out there or anything, you know. I worked 5 months for that man. And at those times, the people, the owners of the land, the growers, they don't pay you every week like over here. They pay you when you're ready to go back to Mexico. You know, they buy you clothes, cigarettes, whatever you need. But that is deducted. I was little, and I missed my mother. I was only 13. But my dreams was come to the United States and make a little few dollars and go back and buy me one of those push cars and sell peanuts, candy, whatever you could sell, but make a living together with my family. I told the man that I was that I wanted to see my mother. And he gave me an answer by saying, well, tomorrow my wife will go downtown and they give you a ride up to the bus station. And you could buy the ticket there, and from here, going towards Mexico, the immigration don't stop you, don't ask you nothing. coming this way, yes, they do ask you. I said, well, that's nice. So I went back, and I went to sleep at night around 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock. I thought somebody was grabbing my hands. And it was the immigration put in there.
Yeah.
What do you call it? Across the street, the boss was there, and the immigration gave me permission. He took me there to knock on the door, and that door never opened. That door never was opened to me. I never got paid. And I was sent to one town they call in McAllen, Texas. And from there they sent me to Reynosa, Tamaulipas. This is how I began to come to the United States, because I was angry, I was mad. I was mad that this American soldier abused my sister, and I came to the United States and I got abused too. With my sweat, my ideas, trying to make a living. So I come back. I wanted to get a hold of that man, but I didn't know which way he took me, you know. So I just jumped the first train that I came, I jumped in it, and I end up in a town called Greeley, Colorado. There I did some sugar beets, you know. So that was my beginning to come, but I was that angry inside of me. Now, I'd like to move into the story. Cesar Chávez, I said to you that I was a regional striker from the 1965. I ran into Cesar Chávez in Delano, California. And what he was talking about people being able to make a little bit more money. They have toilets in the fields. They have drinking water conditions. And I was the king. What do you call that?
The water
can? Well, you can keep medicine in the drawing case.
First aid kit.
In case you have an accident, you know?
First aid.
A first aid kit?
And the growers, they didn't want to comply with that. So to me, it made a lot of sense. But to me, also, there was something else that I was not in Cesar Chavez's head. To me, it was revenge. You know what revenge is, right?
You give
a black eye, I give you another one. And Cesar Chavez said, no. This is not a question of revenge. This is not a question of killing anybody. This movement is a nonviolent movement. We don't know what nonviolent really was. But Cesar Chavez taught us. And he explained to us many ways that he could, that violence won't bring something good. Violence, and I was a violent person, you wouldn't allow me to come to here, talk to you, talk to your family, talk to your wife, talk to your kids. So it began to make sense to us. So the Filipino brothers went on the strike first. But 8 days, a week later, the Mexicans joined the Filipinos. And it was a struggle. First we thought that Cesar Chavez understood exactly what we was getting into, and they're not. We thought that the glory was an enemy. But it was not that. These ones are little towns. And those little towns, they control the compadres, you know. As the chief of police, the director of the school, you know, we begin to see the whole system where we was up against them. And the church. Mexican people were Catholics. We used to go to the church. It got to the point that we cannot go to the church because the growers were there. And we took it that we give quarters and dimes and dollars, and the growers gives a check. I think it's a lot of difference, you know? So we couldn't be in mass together with those people. So they put us in an empty lot, called in the 40-acre lot. And that's what we used to have service. So that was the beginning of the strike. We began to see that it was very difficult. Most of you know, I don't know, you belong to the union. If you belong to the union, you know, is you have 51% of the cards signed. That grower had to agree to an election. Not a contract, but an election. We had 100%, and there's no law that it says that he has to submit to an election. Also, right here, we got what we call in minimum wage. In agriculture, the farm workers are not covered under the minimum wage. You know, there are laws like theirs that they don't protect the farm workers. And this is one of the reasons you see many farm workers who don't have recognition political, because we travel from state to state, all the way from Texas to California, and then go back. Some we come over here, some we go in Ohio, you know. Different places you find a lot of the farm workers, you know. So it was getting too difficult. Then we have, you know what you call the immigration, the border patrol, something like this?
Yeah.
The strike was in Delano, Mepala, and Rich Grove, Corcoran, those are the areas that were the strike concentrated. Little Ford, called Fresno, it's a lot of grapes, pasa.
Raisins.
That's in that area, you know. But the immigration used to catch people there and bring them all the way down to Delano, which is about 150 miles, and let them go there. And they let them go so they could go and break the strike. Because the growers wanted to pick up the grapes. And that was the time that as I began to see that it was getting hotter and hotter. Then we made a march from Delano to Sacramento, which is 350 miles. When we started 100 people. Then somebody came and chose one movie that we called in the Salt of the Earth. Salt of the Earth. The men got, they were miners, and they went on the strike, and the police put them in jail, and the wife took over the car, the signs, and they went on picket, and they win the strike. So they come in and showed to the land to the women, and by the time we know, it was a whole bunch of women and kids together, much of it was us, you know. And it was very hard because we didn't have no food, we didn't have nothing. So we used to go up in the town, like this is the town, and we had told you that some farm workers are coming. They said you could help us out, bring us rice, beans, whatever. And this is how we got together. We keep going like this, and we got to Sacramento. By the time we got to Sacramento, it was 10,000 people. Believe me, that's when we discovered that our problem, it could not be get fixed by ourselves. We cannot win the strike and the Leno. Because you put 100 or 500 people, tomorrow you got a town. Because the borders are very close. So it was very difficult. And people, you know, when you're hungry and you get mad, and it's all kinds of possibilities. It would be a violence, it would be something. And that's when Cesar Chavez, many people, when he went to Sacramento, was asked, a lot of people from people in Chicago went up there. And they give us the name. If you someday in Chicago, give us a call and we help you. So Cesar Chavez started asking volunteers. When it comes to the city, many of us, we didn't speak English very much. many as we never been in the city, small towns, you know. And it's a lot of difference. When you live in Chicago, you know how deep it is. You know, if you go to New York, it's worse, you know. So we come in and we knock the door and said, Cesar Chavez, send me here. And he gives two, three names. And this is how we start asking people to help us out, to make a sacrifice for the farm workers. And you know what the sacrifice we ask you? Not to eat the grapes, not to buy the grapes. And it's not because there was something wrong with the grapes. It was wrong with the conditions of the farm workers who were working on it. You know. And by sacrificing not eating that pound of grapes, that would send a strong message to the growers. Some of the stores here, they, when he conserved the grapes, they lowered down to 10 and 15 cents a pound of the grapes. And that's when we start asking people, please don't buy nothing there. Don't buy no grapes, don't buy no food. Go to the next store. And that worked. People in the store began to notice that you're losing not only the pound of grapes, but you lost $70 or $80 worth of groceries to that person who was going to buy it. And that makes sense to them. And that's how they start taking the grapes from the shelves. We were sent to Boston, Massachusetts, all New England. We talked to all the first national stop and shop in the big stores. And they helped us by not having a grape. And that's the way that the farm workers was able to overcome and have more scopes than what we had before. Nonviolence is a beautiful word to say, but it's a very hard thing to do. Nonviolence is not only to do the nonviolence a person like me. This other person and this other person had to give the opportunity to make work the nonviolence. Okay? And people here in Chicago give us an opportunity. They had a small house meetings, you know, 6-7 people. Some people help us pass out leaflets in the church, just what you, some of you guys doing, you know, advertising the things. Some ladies, they never pick it in their life. They won't mind pass 3 leaflets, and then when they run up, we give them another 3. And this is how people got involved. The churches got involved, the nuns, housewives. All these people began to give us opportunity. Because all these people began to help us, politicians, you know the political people, right? The politicians, kind of funny people. The politicians, it's like the water goes away, the corriente, you know? When they start seeing that that lady and that man and that family, you know, begin to support it, the politician went to come and take a picture with us. They said that he was a good guy. Why the politician knew that the farm workers all this time had been out there with no minimum wage, no laws to protect them. And then all of a sudden he begins to take pictures because he wants you to give him the vote. Not so much for my vote, but your vote. And you as the people made those kind of changes and it was made, you know. But you see the fish you did?
Okay.
To support the farm workers. We organized this much. Steel ditch match. So we got a long way to go. But we have met a lot of beautiful people throughout this country. Mm-hmm. I was in Boston. I didn't speak very much English. Now I'm a real English, you know. I speak good now, you know. But when I was invited me to a place, he called himself Harvard University. And when I find out who those people, that they were very smart. And I said, oh my God, I was nervous. I don't know the English and I keep going in Spanish. But it was some of the young people that know one word or two words and they helped me out. So I made it through, you know? You know, and this is how I learned the English. I learned so much that I conquered an Irish girl. Me and my wife, we've been married 47 years now. You know, he helped us a lot, Tania, too, you know, and he's been a very good wife for me, you know. But this is part of the sacrifice that you make, you know. Now I live here in Chicago. I stay here in Chicago. I'm married, I have a daughter. And I don't want my daughter to go back in the farm to pick grapes. And I'm full of shoes, you got kids. You don't want your son, your daughter to go out and pick grapes for $6-$7 an hour, you know? You don't want your wife and your daughter to go to do the toilet and when there's no toilet, you know? So these kinds of conditions will need to be changed. Farm workers are workers, people, you know, we work hard, and you notice something. You know, when a farm worker comes to a city or any place to look for a job, we never ask how much you're going to pay. We just want to work. And whatever you pay is, you pay us, you know, and therefore they will make a progress, you know. And we are hard-working people, but so now I stay here in Chicago. I work for one company called Denley Machine Corporation. Then after that, I went to work in a hospital, a two-county hospital, sleeping and mopping, you know. I make my living, but I got my my daughter educated. Now I have a daughter and I got a grandson, real tall kid, you know. And I'm very proud of that. So I decided to stay here in Chicago. You know, I cannot give myself, my age is 74 years old now. I can't do what I do used to do, you know, but I still want to share with you, you know, the struggle that happened to the farm worker. And I do want to put some impact and then I open up for questions. Many people we know as a Chávez because it's a labor leader. Cesar Chávez, he was not a labor leader. Cesar Chávez was born in Arizona, and it was dry season, forced their parents to lose the little farm that they had. And so they started coming in towards California to migrant work. Cesar Chávez got a little educated, by the name, a person named Fred Ross. He teach him how to read, how to write. Then they got him involved. In some organization, they used to call him a CSO. CSO?
Community Service Organization.
And they used to help the people in the city, you know. But then they look at the farm workers and they say, who's helping the farm workers? And he wanted the organization to go and work with them, and they didn't want it because there was no money. A lot of these organizations work with grants, you know. So Cesar Chávez quit the CSO, so fue a work to Delano and work. So what I'm trying to say to you, Cesar Chávez got people like me and many others that we didn't have no hope. We know we was poor, we know we got exploited, but we don't know what to do. And it's hard. So Cesar Chávez taught us to learn by ourselves who we are. Who we are now, you know. And once you know yourself, once you respect yourself, then the rest of the things come together. But sometimes we were so busy for that gentleman to recognize me when I cannot recognize myself. They won't do me no good for him to recognize me. But once that I recognize myself, and look at what I've done, I got a family. I got a wife, I got a grandson, I got a kid, I got a house. You know what I mean? I built it. And thanks to Cesar Chavez, Jimmy, their understanding in life. So, you're going to see the movie. It's not the movies, we've got several movies you do that they give you the sacrifice that the people going through. But to be a farm worker is not an easy thing to do. And as you know, if you want to face realities, American has a problem because you got too many people being read and write. You have a problem. You have a problem because you are not going to go to the fields and pick grapes, pick tomatoes for $5 or $6, isn't it? So that problem we got in the teachings, as I said, our savior is going to be when we learn how to read and write. Education is when it's going to make it overcome. I come into the city and I talk to many people. And you know what the majority of the priority of the man and the woman? My son to go to college. That's a good feeling, you know. I want my kids to go to college too. And to be equal as you are and your family are. So I hope I can give you some understanding. It's a long story, but thank you very much for all that, sir.
Okay, we'll get the question and answers. Hang on.
All right.
Who's got a question? Okay, we'll start with Tim. I know you got a question. Go ahead.
Okay. I'd like to know two things. What finally got you off the farm, and how did you meet your lovely wife?
You're liking what?
What?
How?
How did you finally leave the farm work, and then how did you meet your wife?
Well, I was in Delano picking grapes, and that day the strike started, and there was a group of people asking us to come and join them. And the things that they were saying, it was things that was true, that was underpaid and all these. So I come out. I was scared. Believe me, I was scared. So, now you wouldn't know how I meet my wife.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to tell you a little thing. Close to Rebecca Field is a town, his name is Boston. You know, the little town, we used to come there and do the robotos cebolla. Pick the onions, you know, and tie them up and get a bunch of you seen in the store. Mm-hmm. And it's a family that's, you know, coming in, and you know, I was a kid, but I like to have a girlfriend, and I had one girl there that I like it so much. And I haven't seen him for a while. So when Cesar Chavez asked for volunteers to go to Boston, I raised my hand.
Uh-huh.
And then they told me to go back to Bakersfield and get some clothes. So I got one pen, one jacket, you know. They put me in the plane. They were not talking about the same town that I was talking. They was talking about Boston, Massachusetts. So they gave me $5 and 3 names. That was the method of the justification for this as a teacher I had to organize. So we went to a group of priests that to send letters. And I went to ask him and see if he would loan us their letters. So we sent some letters to test friends. And my wife and another ladies come over and start helping. And I don't know if it's because I was a nice looking guy or what, you know. But it's been 47 years. 47 years, believe me, it looked like it was yesterday.
Okay, we got a couple
questions.
You had your hand up before, go ahead.
All right, sir. Tough struggle. I saw the movie, Tough Struggle. Man, oh man, my heart goes out to you guys. There's still, like you just said, there's a long, long way to go. There's a group who's very vocal in America, and my question is, I'm not sure why you guys ever reached out to this group. It's called the National Advancement for Colored People. A very vocal group. Why haven't the farm workers reached out to the NAACP?
Yeah, that's the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. Yes, have you?
We went to a lot of towns and a lot of places, like I said, you know, we went. And they introduced us right here with, in Boston, there was a group that was until
STS.
Right, that was back in the
60's. That's the Students for a Democratic Society.
And
they helped me. We went to the nuns and the seminaries, and they helped us, you know. Who asked them for help? But there are some groups that want us to fight. And we was condemned to be fighters, you know.
NAACP and many various locals were very supportive to the farm workers movement. The thing that Chávez understood was that in a small, isolated, rural community, you couldn't win the strike because as many people as you took out from the ranch, the growers were able to replace them by recruiting people from Mexico to come in. And still today, all of the national labor laws, the Wagner Act, the Taft-Hartley Act, that gave the right to unionize to workers, specifically excluded agricultural workers. Still today, California is the only state that has passed a labor, agricultural labor organizing act. And so there's been a real shift. When the original labor laws were passed, farming was more of a family business. It's become a corporate enterprise where the grower isn't a guy that's in the field with the worker. He's off in New York City in the corporate headquarters somewhere, or Hartford or Chicago or wherever. And so the situation has changed, but the laws haven't changed because most people don't see what goes on in rural areas. So the real issue is you have to organize the workers in the field, and then you need the support of people from the cities. And that was the advantage of the boycott. Instead of, if you fought and it became violent, the farm workers had nothing to fight with. The growers and the sheriffs had plenty to fight with. And so you knew that wasn't a winning strategy. The economic impact of middle-class Americans that were willing to not just not eat grapes, but one of the advantages of the lack of laws covering agricultural workers is they could do a secondary boycott. And that's truly what forced the major supermarket chains to stop carrying grapes. And that created the economic impact
on
the growers. Yeah. It's very powerful. The truth is, people-to-people connection is more powerful than money and authority.
All right.
And it's when we get to come together.
Let me tell you, right now, we depend on a lot of the people. We come to the city, a group like yours. A lot of you people, what it does, give us the address, and we'll put them in there in California.
You didn't get your mask.
And then they send you.
Did you?
No.
Newsletters.
Newsletters.
Emails.
New typing. And then they send a thing to congressmen, to the politicians. You know, so it's not longer farm workers putting pressure on the politicians, but people like yourself, you are citizens. You've got the tools in your hands. And that's what it takes for you guys to help.
Sid, did you have a question?
Yeah. I know a lot of pesticides were used on the grapes, and maybe you could talk about it, how it made people sick that were picking the grapes.
Well, the pesticides has been a big problem, but let me also explain to you the ignorance in ourselves, you know. For people like me, that we don't read or write, you know. Pesticides, it was indicated, one more daily work. Recently, the pesticides have been coming so dangerous because the plane comes in and it sprays, lands over there and it throws the bucket. In the summertime, the kids come over, you know, kids are kids. Anything they can get to play. And we have a lot of accidents with the pesticides. Cesar brought other people to look at the whole question of the pesticides. And he made a stink a little bit. Sometimes you go in the truck and that way you spray into the big Johnson grass. By the time you come back, that grass is dead already. And we never realized that, you know. So pesticides is becoming a big problem. It's a town named Bakersfield, California. Yeah, there used to be farm workers. We got a big corral of cattle. You know, when you go to the cattle farm, you could smell it pretty strong, isn't it? You know? Well, maybe the pesticides and all that stuff. Now, a lot of people sold their houses in Los Angeles, in LA, all those areas, and they come in to Bakersfield and buy it because it was cheaper. Now they don't know what to do because these strong pesticides are coming in. Now these people putting people to say something to those people from the pesticides, you know. But
part of where Marcos is going is that farm workers were actually sprayed along with the
pesticides. Yeah, I know.
And back during the 70s, there was, you know, Rachel Carson wrote the book Silent Springs, and began to create more awareness of the dangers of pesticides. There have been public health projects where they see the incidence of children born with deformities and disabilities caused by the exposure of parents to pesticides. The most contaminated airspace in the country is actually that agricultural area in California, the Central Valley. And it's not just the pesticides, it's also the mega dairies that he was referencing that have grown up where you've got just thousands of cows kept. Similar to the way they raise chickens in this country, where you've got thousands of chickens all crowded together in Quonset huts where they've got no real room to move around. So this, as agricultural land has been sold off and tract housing developments have started to spur up, there's more middle class people, and they've started campaigns to stop the spraying of pesticides on some of these crops because of the drift with the wind is impacting people in these houses. When it was just farm workers in the field, there was much less awareness. But there's growing awareness today of the need to restrict and control the use of chemicals.
All right. Anybody else have any questions? Yes, Ernie.
Yeah. Excuse me. Are there any current boycotts going on with regard to farm products?
No, there's not a current boycott. The boycott with grapes ended back in the late 70s. There is organizing of different crops still going on, and not just in California. There's a group in Florida, the Immokalee Farm Workers in Florida. There's a group in Ohio. Flock Farm Labor Organizing Committee, but there's a lot of work still to be done. And in an environment where we have a governor and others that want to restrict the rights of people that have had unions and the ability to organize themselves, there's been a real deterioration and a pushback against organized labor in this country that makes it difficult for all workers in general.
All right. Tim,
Do you see any hope now? I mean, with you have Walmart, you have a lot of low-wage jobs. Do you see any hope in the lower-end worker standard of living going up in the next few years, or do you think that it's just going to be more of the same corporate where the rich get richer and the poor get poorer? And
I think that depends on what we all do about it. If we sit and allow them to strip us of our rights, it will continue to be a huge problem. If we organize ourselves and respond to efforts to organize and support those efforts to organize, we know from our experience that people united together can accomplish great things. So it's up to us.
And as a corollary, what do you think of machine agriculture, like when they come up with a machine that picks the grapes and everything like that?
They have for wine grape is mostly machine picked tomatoes.
Which I don't recommend.
You know, the tomato that you eat today that you get in the supermarket is not the same as what we grew up with as children. It doesn't have the juiciness, it doesn't have the flavor. Those tomatoes have been tampered with and changed in order to allow machines to pick them so that they don't get bruised and damaged. So this whole question about genetically altered food products, I think, is a very timely issue that we face.
In the farm, we're facing a problem. And basically what we're saying is that we got machines. We got machines for melons. We got machines for tomatoes. We got machines for corn, for cotton, different crops. Here in the city, you got machines too, you know. You work in a factory. I don't know how many of you guys work in a factory, but you work in a factory, you know. Sometimes in this machine here, it takes 3-4 people. Now, you know what it takes? One person and a little tape like that, and you put it in, and the damn machine does everything. It'll eat you there the most. So how do you expect you to buy a car, or buy food, or buy something else if you're not making it? Right. And agriculture will go through the same thing. That's why Cesar Chavez said, believe me, but I'm saying that, Cesar Chavez said that the only salvation we're going to be able to have when we get educated. Because he could take anything away from you, but he can't take that education from your head. So little by little, we will be educated. But we still depend on you and a lot of things. So please help us and give us your blessings whenever you can. Thank you very much.
I got another question over here. Jonathan?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Thank you very much for being here today and speaking. What role did music play in farm workers organizing?
That's a great question. He's asking what role did music play? From the very beginning in the farm workers, there was one guy, Luis Valdez, who created the Teatro Campesino. And it was kind of like the old morality plays of a long time ago, where you educated people that didn't read or write. They'd wear signs that would say the grower, the labor contractor, the farm worker, and they'd act out little skits. Music was always part of every farm worker gathering. There was always somebody with a guitar that was always singing. There were strike songs, there were labor movement songs, De Colores, there were lots of them. And that was part of what brings people together too. Chávez always said, you have to have the joy, you have to have the celebration in order to renew the human spirit. It's an important part of organizing, is celebrating.
Does anybody else have a question? If nobody has a question at this time, I actually had one or two questions. Well, one question. What has the United Farm Workers been able to accomplish since it was organized? I mean, it was organized originally by Cesar Chavez, is that correct?
Yeah. It's done two things. One is, currently in the state of California, there are several industries that are in fact organized. Mushrooms, strawberries, some of the lettuce. There's about 50,000 members that are working under union contracts in California. Nowhere near where it needs to be. And again, California is the largest agricultural state in the country, but it's certainly not the only agricultural state, so there's a long way to go. Chávez also sparked a movement that impacted cities. Here in Chicago, for example, when we were here boycotting grapes and lettuce and some wines and different products at different times, there was a group of people in Pilsen that wanted a new high school for their kids, the Benito Juarez High School. And there was, the city was trying to gather the land together to build the high school. And there was one chicken, Pollo Loco, or whatever the name of it was, that was refusing to sell or settle with the state.
Is this a restaurant?
Yeah.
Pollo Loco.
It was a restaurant in Pilsen on 18th Street.
Yeah, yeah, I know. I've eaten at Pollo Loco.
Well, at any rate, the bottom line, the people from Pilsen Neighbors and APO, other community organizations, came and talked with Marcos and said, well, what can we do? He said, you know what to do. Put a picket line in front of it and tell people don't eat there. And so they didn't eat, and the business sold, finally settled with the city. And the city helped them move up to a much better location than where they were. They were right at the intersection, Blue Island, Loomis, and 18th. There's a McDonald's there now. Chicken place is long gone. They were the first Latinos that ran for political office to represent communities here in Chicago, were people that were active. Jesus Garcia just ran for mayor, lost, but forced more discussion than would have been had he not won. He picketed with the farm workers when he was a student in college at University of Illinois. Rudy Lozano, Cha-Cha Jimenez, there were a lot of people that had an awakening of political awakening, who understood that only by organizing to bring pressure on what we want to change will we accomplish change. There's a new high school in Little Village down at 31st and Costner. 15 mothers did a 19-day hunger strike to get that high school built. Daley had promised a high school. When you look at the demographics of Chicago public schools, Latinos are the largest group. 60% of kids in CPS are Latinos. And he promised the school. At the same time, they set aside $5 million to develop and plan a high school in Little Village. They started planning the Near North Academy and the Walter Payton Academy. They all were funded to be planned at the same time. 5 years later, in the year 2000, Walter Payton and Near North opened up. Little Village still hadn't had a single meeting. So 15 mothers went out on a hunger strike. They named, they pitched tents on the land where the school was to be built. They named it Camp Cesar Chavez. And every night they had music. There was dancing, there was music, there were, they had marches from churches and organizations. There were posters going up in windows. We need a new high school now. And so all of, that's the legacy of Cesar Chavez, not just the impact on farm workers, but through the efforts of the boycott and people in the cities, both Latinos learning, they have a voice, they can stand up. They can create change, but more than just Latinos. Labor unions, middle class workers that said, we can, if we work together, change what we want.
Wow.
Tim, you have two questions for
right.
Dave hasn't had a question. Dave,
okay.
It's not a question, it's a point of order. Would you be kind enough to repeat that instruction that people should silence their electronic devices?
Oh,
somebody
well, you've already said it for me. I don't know if there's an electronic, is there an electronic,
Are you talking, what are you talking about?
Vacuum. Turn off your cell phones.
The vacuum is somebody was...
Somebody here was beeping with their phone.
Okay, well, our speaker had a phone, but he switched it off. But look, I don't know if anybody in the audience has a cell phone on other than... Yeah, I don't know.
They can hear it.
Oh, well, that's our speaker's cell phone. But is anybody in the audience? I don't think anybody in the audience had a phone.
Somebody was speaking with their
phone. I didn't hear it.
His is off.
Okay, yeah, I didn't hear it, but I, you know, again, when you heard what Dave said, I would want to remind everybody to please either turn their cell phones off or set the ringer to vibrate. And now... does anybody else? Tim, you had another question.
I just want to ask, do you guys, what do you see as the future for organized labor? Do you see it having more of an impact over the next few years, or do you just see more of the same in this country over the next 10 or 15 years?
For the farm workers, it's still hard in winter time to pass the law. You know, once the laws get covered, then it would be some big organized, you know. On the other hand, people from the United Farm Workers come here to Chicago, New York, and different places. And some of the unions hire some of these people to go out door to door, organize, you know. Because sometimes that movement here is just a little weak. Mm-hmm. The union to get weak because they're playing too much politics and not so much people. And you know that the people, I belong here to the steel workers, and we went on a strike there for six, about 9 months, I think. And we used to go house to house and talk to them, and we convinced a lot of people like that. But the whole labor movement is coming to have a big struggle. And sometimes, like today, you hear people talking about the minimum wage for $15. How can you expect a farm worker to live on $6? Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. They're saying, and I'm not educating myself, but they're saying that when the raise is $15, it will take 4 or 5 years before actually real pass the law, you know? Can you imagine how much food is going to cost you by that time?
Right. Mm-hmm.
Do you really got $15? Or you still in the same hole, you know? Lettuce. A lot of people didn't know. You know, 1 box of lettuce is a 20 head, 24 heads mm-hmm. in a box. Back in 1965, they used to pay us 32 cents a box, you know, and that is divided between two cutters and one packer. That's the way we work in the other field, you know. So you're talking about 12 cents a piece in a box. Mm-hmm. You come to the supermarket, dollar something, mm-hmm. you know. I was eating the lettuce that you sent me out there, and they were so good. I said, I don't know how much it even costs, but I'm going to eat it right now. You know? But all I'm saying, the time is getting harder for you also too.
The real dilemma that we face, I think, in this country today is the inequity of the rich getting richer and richer and the erosion of the middle class wage as we lost manufacturing. And we went more to a service economy. The success of Henry Ford back in the day was that the people on the production line in Detroit could afford to buy the cars. And as working class Americans lose the ability to buy products that are being produced frequently outside this country, we face the dilemma of how do we maintain that middle class for the majority of people. We know we've got a problem with the core, but we've really expanded beyond the core into the erosion of service economy. And I think that's an unsolved problem that I don't know how it's going to go.
All right. Dave.
Yes, how has the drought in California affected the farm workers, not just the union, but its members and what they're trying to do?
It's a real issue in California. So much of the agriculture is dependent on irrigation, and the drought is unprecedented. While people pretend there's no such thing as climate change going on, California is paying the price earlier than a lot of other states. Agriculture has moved toward guest worker programs. If you go out to the Northwest, Oregon, Washington, the average farm worker there today is a Southeast Asian that is brought in for a period of time, and then, like, it's the modern-day version of the old bracero program. And I think the drought is having a major impact. They're not able to plant as much acreage as they have previously.
Do you know that the farmers get so much money for not planting particular land? Well, he's coming to that point too. Because you don't have no water, so a lot of stuff is not going to plant. And that means the cities is going to cost a lot of money. A lot of money, you know. They're not going to plant, but the government, the growers will get so much money from the government, you know. I don't know where it's really coming to, but I guess water's a big problem. In some places, we give the water rights to the cars then instead of to the produce. You look at how many places we got to wash the cars, and gallons and gallons and gallons of water waste there, you know. So we're getting in a rough area. Yes, sir.
Does anybody else have any questions? Yes, Giannis.
Yes.
I'm losing my mind today.
Griego, abogado de Chicago. I'm asking you, senor and senora, you know, I'm concerned about these because my father never made more than a dollar an hour, and I have never made a lot of money myself. So I want to ask, I talked to the girls over here at Lawrence Avenue, a big supermarket, Christmas Day. I say, senora, no Latinos. Bop, 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 thank you. Bop, 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 thank you. That's all. No communication with the people. Then another one at Pulaski Avenue. Same thing, cashier. I said, lady, today Christmas. How much you get? Double, time and a half? No, she said, straight time. I said, how about if you get sick one day? You got two little niños. You get one day sick day from the boss? No. And then I asked, how about a 1 week vacation? No. Here's a question. I said, well, you know, the Mexicano mucho trabajo, the Griego mucho dinero. But now here's my question. After all these movements, all this fight and everything, how come you let these people work like slaves for lunch break, 15 minutes lunch break? Do you know that's going on right here, right in my neighborhood?
Well, we have certain problems. Look, you have unions that begin trying to organize a plant, and a great percentage of the people don't have no papers. So somebody from the plant says, you signed that card for the union, I call the immigration. And right now, to go to Mexico, it's tough to go to Mexico. You know, so we get so many people deported, and here, a lot of people, we keep quiet, hoping that thing with Obama would get passed, and you know, that would help several people. Yes, ma'am.
Hello. Yes, yes, go ahead, Ivana.
I would like to know any competition between Mexican people and Cuba, or it's like the same similarity in cultures and language, or some competition?
It's not competition. Each country.
How Mexicans treat Cubans and how Cubans treat Mexicans in general? Because I'm from Russia, I don't know.
In general, the government of Mexico has always maintained relations with the Cuban government. The United States had the embargo. But the average people in Mexico don't come in contact with Cubans. They come in contact more within this country, where...
No cultural exchange or not?
I can't speak to what Mexico was doing along that lines. I know that you could fly to Cuba from Mexico,
but
no problem.
But let's say, if you would like to go to Cuba, is it any problem for Mexican people?
No, absolutely none. There are regularly scheduled flights every day.
Thank you.
Right.
Are there any other questions? No? All right. Well, let's have another warm round for our speaker. Now, let's get into the rebuttal period. First of all, how many people would like to speak and rebuttal? Okay, let me just get a count of head count here. Okay, everybody wants to speak. Raise your hand. Keep your hands up, folks. Okay, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And that's, I'm going to allow, that's a 10th hand up, and I'm going to add 2, so that makes it 12. Now, we have an hour and 9 minutes. Oh, yeah, no, let's. Now, we got 12, so what we're going to do, let's make it 4 minutes each. How's that sound? Does that sound good, Tim?
You could probably go to 5 and still.
You think with an hour and 9 minutes we can go to 5?
Yeah, because some won't speak all the way, and I'm going to get a clock up here in a minute.
All right, we'll go to. All right, folks, we're going to 5 minutes each, but we got to stay on schedule, Tim.
We will once I'm getting the timer and I'm going to.
All right, So who's going to be the first victim? Come on down. Okay, go ahead. By the way, just a minute. Let me organize some chairs for us here. Hang on. Let me bring some chairs out. I should have done this while the Q&A was being done, but I'll do it now. Right, these are the on-deck chairs, folks. So this is get in line. If you're second in line after the rebuttal speaker, just take, let me move these chairs a little over to get the speaker room. Just sit in one of these chairs here.
Damn it. Yeah, okay. Anybody here see the Treasure of Sierra Madre?
I've seen it.
Very good movie. And I remember there was one part in there where this American is recruiting Mexican workers. I don't remember what kind of job, probably on a farm or something. And he says, he'll pay him and everything, and they have to meet him in a certain spot, and they'll get their pay after a day or two work. So the guy never shows up, and that was really typical of a lot of people that recruited Mexican labor in Mexico. And I forget the author of that, is a very good writer.
B. Traven.
Yeah, B. Traven. And he really wrote about Mexico and all the problems, and he lived in a small town in a village in Mexico because he didn't like so-called civilization, where people exploited one another, and a lot of commercialism and things of that nature. And he wrote a lot about Mexico. In fact, if you talk to anybody that drives a cab in Mexico at the time that he was living, everybody knew B. Traven. So the thing is about labor is all these workers, no matter what particular job they're doing, whether they're working in a fast food place, whether they're working on a farm, whether they're working in a factory, so forth and so on, they have to unify one another in order to make a real dent as far as living conditions are concerned. And now we got what they call neoliberalism, where they're going around the world looking for the cheapest labor you could possibly get anywhere in the world, and they're exploiting them like crazy. And something like 0.1% own almost all the wealth of the planet. So you have extreme conditions. And under these extreme conditions, the only thing worthwhile is you have to get rid of the system that we're living under now. Because the system we're living under, super exploitation. What is labor actually? Labor produces all the wealth, and capital takes that wealth and uses it for itself to get richer and richer and richer. It's exploitation. And the worker is nothing but a wage slave. That's all he really is. And people talk about slavery. Well, the worker is a slave. Let's face it. So they have to take over and run the thing themselves in order to get just society. I don't believe that under this condition they're living now, under capitalism, you can really have a just wage and a living wage and have the rights that most people need, like health, schooling, decent housing, decent medical care, and things of that nature. You can't possibly do it under this system, and the system is just getting worse and worse and worse. And if we don't do something about it, the system will destroy everything. Like, for instance, he was talking about global warming. Look what's happening in California, the drought. Look what's happening in Florida. The water is rising, and Florida will be underwater in about 30 years. So the situation is so dire that we have to get rid of this type of system that is nothing but based on exploitation of labor. That's all it is.
Okay, next.
Okay. We'll go by age. So Sid is older than me. I usually run to get first, but I'm second because
the clock is running.
Good. Stop it for 5 seconds. I finished. Okay. Now, the question, ladies and gentlemen, is the rich know what kind of world we're living in, but the workers don't know. And one guy that I don't think he ever came to America, but I read a couple of pages of Lenin, he said, nowhere in the world are the workers exploited as ruthlessly as they are in America. And Chicago Tribune confirmed that 10, 20 years ago. There was an article that said of all the 16 industrialized countries in the world, the USA is number 16 on the bottom. See, we live with a lot of illusions of grandeur and freedom and democracy and all these toxic class war weapons, which we don't realize. So in no other country do the workers have such lack of vacations, lack of medical care, lack of good pensions, lack of sick pay. The movie sequel by, that famous?
Michael Moore.
He showed in France, a woman has a baby, she's got 3 months, 3 years would pay to raise a little child, a healthy future citizen. Over here, you tell them you want 3 weeks or 3 days, they say, we got another Mexicana coming to take your job right now, so go home and then go on unemployment compensation. So, you see, this is the most cruel, like Lenin said, as far as the workers are concerned, the most cruel system is the USA. But see, the middle class, they hate. I heard this on Northwestern University radio about a month ago, this correspondent calling from Brazil to Chuck Mertz. This is all radio Saturday morning. And he said one thing about those rich people that govern the big nation in South America. the rich. They hate the working people. It's a manifestations of hate, and it's one way is they give people the illusion of grandeur, telling them they're middle class. So here, a man makes $45,000 at the post office or in some factory or anywhere, and his wife makes another $35,000. He says, "Hey, who middle class? You're not middle class. You know, if you think you're middle class, if you're making $100,000 or $200,000 a year, and you have to work to make that money, you're laboring under delusions of grandeur. Because if you can make $100,000, $200,000, $300,000 a year without working for the rest of your life, that's when you're middle class. But see, this is one of the toxic weapons that the ruling class uses by describing working people as middle class. And they fall into that themselves. You see, working class, you see, union people, they use these toxic phrases, calling their workers, union workers, middle class. So another thing is freedom, human rights, gay equality, democracy, civil society, racial equality, pro-life and anti-abortion. All of these issues are designated, they are intended to divide the working class. So that's why we are so exploited from the cradle to the grave. And that, besides that, they killed us, scoundrels. Look at this. A couple of days ago here, the Wall Street Journal said in USA, hospital-acquired infections kill 75,000 people in the United States every year. And about a year ago, Wall Street Journal had written, the hospitals and the doctors love hospital-acquired infections because they can keep you 2-3 more days and make bigger profits. So there is a class war going on. The rich are killing the poor. The poor are unable to defend themselves, and they have no idea that they are being exploited and victimized. And I'm finishing with a story a very wise Turkish neighbor of mine told me about 25 years ago. God rest his soul. He said, I'm Greek, he's Turkish, but he's my brother.
Okay.
He says, you know, in old days, these workers in the farm, they said, hey, we're going to go to the boss and say, we want higher wages, we want food, we're not eating. And he said, hey, he comes out there, he says, you time's people, up. You think?
Your time's up.
Look at me, I drink all the wine every day, but nobody feels sorry for me.
Okay.
I didn't get the gentleman's name who gave the talk tonight.
Munoz.
I'm sorry.
Marcos Munoz.
Marcos. Well, Mr. Marcos' point is well taken, that when people come here from across the border, many of them get exploited and have a very tough time. But I think Mr. Marcos may have missed the point. The enemy was not the people that had the farms that exploited them. The enemy was ignorance, not knowing to read and write and so forth. And if these people had been able to speak English and could read and write before they came here, they would have had a much better chance going in. The thing is that we've had certain other people talk about the exploitation and the terrible things we have in this country. But the fact is, there's almost no greater prosperity in any other country. More people own homes and live decently in this country than almost any other country. We are not a country that needs to destroy our system and erect some Leninist or socialist or communist system, because I can point when one gentleman says that we had 75,000 people a year die from infections in hospitals. That might be due to carelessness, but under Stalin, we had 20 million people die of starvation. When we had our Great Depression, nobody starved. No, we have a good country. We just need to restore some of the old values that have been taken away. And when Mr. Marcos talks about higher wages and so forth, the question has to come about, at whose expense do these greater wages come from? At the expense of people who have to buy produce and fruit and vegetables. They have to pay more, so it just drives the price up. A $15 an hour wage, which many people are insisting on nowadays, will wind up running the price of food so high that people like McDonald's and Burger King will begin robotizing. You'll find yourself with many, many less jobs. And what we need is for people to be able to advance themselves by bettering themselves with better education and so forth. Thank you.
All right, all right, all right. All right, thank you. Great, great presentation, Mr. Munoz. Mr. Munoz, appreciate you very much. I'm telling you once again, I saw the movie. Everybody should go see that movie. Heart-wrenching. You're right, there's that much more still to go. Heart-wrenching. On that note, somebody mentioned about global warming. This has been a really sore spot for me for years. We keep on talking about global warming, climate change, deniers. We have these, you know, two different groups. The right says they're denying, and the left says climate change. But no one's talking about the real issue. And I would like to start a discussion. It's called, begins with a P, it's called pollution. Please, left, call it pollution. Right, pollution. And we can begin the conversation, please. So quit calling it climate change, quit denying it. Let's start calling it what it really is, and let's work on cleaning up America. It's called pollution. Please, everybody, I appreciate that very much. All right, also, capitalism, I love Sid. Sid, I love you, baby. You love capitalism. You said that about 3 months ago, right? In your presentation. The reason you said it, you need capitalization, or I'm sorry, capitalism. I'm sorry, you said you need capitalism, right? You said you needed capitalism, and then because of a high output, which is what we have in capitalism, very high output, and then you can springboard into socialism. So Sid is a big advocate of capitalism. He must have capitalism. I love you, Sid. Thank you very much. And on that note, sir, both you gentlemen, we have socialism in America. I know you guys know that. We have free schools. And now in Chicago, we have 2 years of college. That's socialism, gentlemen, okay? We have free health care. I don't know if anybody knows this. Are there any health care workers in the audience? If anybody gets hurt and you go, you're taken to the emergency room, you cannot be denied health care. No. You must be stabilized, and then you're set free on your own. But you gotta be stabilized. Just so you guys know that. That's another socialism that exists. We also have free healthcare clinics. You go to a doctor and don't have to pay anything. Okay? We have free food. Lots of free food in this country.
Where?
Food depositories, food banks. We have 600 food places in the Cook County area. Take a day to volunteer at the food depository at Pulaski and 47. They'll tell you all about it after you get done volunteering for half a day. We have lots of food for people. Socialism is a beautiful thing. It's going on already in America. Please. Also, we have free books, free CDs,
You know what that's, you know what that's called? The library. Free, baby, free. Socialism. Everybody's equal, okay? It's beautiful, beautiful. All right, and also, I want to share, Mr. Munoz, you mentioned it, and so did David. I would like to recruit, or I would like to get on the bandwagon with both you guys, and I want to start a revolution of going downtown when we have these people shouting out about $15 an hour. Okay. I want Mr. Munoz, David, and myself to share our story why $15 an hour isn't bad. And coming from the people who know the best, Mr. Munoz, he stood up here and said that it's bad. $15 an hour is a minimum wage, is bad.
No,
exactly. And we understand why it's bad.
Why?
Because the place is gonna be closing down. People cannot afford to pay $17 for a hamburger. It's gonna go outrageous, okay? So I want to get on your bandwagon, Mr. Munoz, Mrs. Munoz, and David. Bring me with you. I will gladly share stories and carry signs against these $15 an hour people. All right? Also, going back to socialism, great movie I just saw. It's called The Giver. The Giver has anybody seen The Giver? Ever heard about it?
Yes.
The Giver was a beautiful concept. And I'm not saying good or bad, but this is a concept of what socialism really is. It was a very, very touching movie. Look it up. Please rent it, The Giver, okay? Thanks, everybody.
On YouTube, Steve. Steve, where you can see this movie? On YouTube?
No. Okay, go ahead, when you're ready.
My name is Raj Patel. I speak for myself. I had a sister-in-law who was unhappy with her husband. He can't make enough money. So I bought her a record, I Never Promise You Rose Garden. I think probably nobody promised us Rose Garden. People who came to America and went west, I know how much they went through. I know people who lived in Chicago and established this town, how much they went through. And I know now all over America and in New York City, what kind of apartment places they lived in. Okay, so that is for that. When times are bad at night in the winter, I think about Jesus Christ and with that Jewish guy. I forgot the name, okay?
Moshe.
No, that guy came from Egypt, okay?
Moses.
Moses, okay? Moses. And do you know, Moses never got his dream.
No.
You don't perfect.
He never got his dream.
What?
He never got his dream to see the land, okay?
I don't understand.
Okay, and Jesus Christ, what was his dream? He wanted to be king of Jews. He never became one. You know, he never became one king. He never became king of Jews. You know, he didn't become any anything. It was Saint Paul made him the big guy. Okay, let's see what's going on in the world by the time, which might affect you guys. China is now number one in the world. It has a more income, more product GDP than any other country, including America. So first time in a probably long time, some other country had overtaken us. Something we not know, the India and Israel, they're getting closer and closer. And their closeness is based on education. Everybody believes in education. Everybody believes in hard work. Everybody believes in innovation. And those countries are very well. And I think every other country, every other individual can do that. Iran and 5+ negotiations are going a lot better than most American things. And it is possible. The two foreign ministers of two countries, ours and Iran's, they may get Nobel Peace Prize. I have a great deal of respect for Baltimore mayor, prosecutor, and Maryland, or whatever it was, is a governor. I think they did excellent job. And police department, they did excellent job. And I think we should notice that. Second thing, first time happened is that mayor of the city called up those guys thugs, and president of our Palolita. Because this thing has to be done. I've been fighting with NAACP, National Advance of Colored People. I've been fighting with them. I say, hey, guys, you guys have to have a character. Martin Luther said, let me join my character. I think what has happened is that in a black community, young black men have lost their character. They are not displaying character. What happened? And do you know, if anybody is poor, they want to come up, or their kids want to come up, there's only one way. Education, culture, and good behavior. If you don't have that, forget it. You know, you cannot be begging for $15. You cannot be government not doing and giving me job. You cannot be talking about the city is not giving me job or this and that. No, it doesn't work. That woman who chases her son, she says it's my responsibility and I'm going to take care of it. And she did. Okay, what happened? I think our black leaders are bankrupt in this country. And I've been telling them for the last 30 years. I've been writing about it. I've been calling NAACP. I say, you are not training your people. You are complaining. You want something? I say, you want white men to change? Huh? You say, I want white men to change? White men never going to change. White men, DNA is so created that he exploits everybody. They've been exploiting for 600-700 in a colonial countries. They rob Africa, they rob Asia. Okay? So I said, forget about white men. You're going to beg for white men for your freedom? What is wrong with you? You beg for freedom? You're going to take it in America. In America.
Do you know something in America?
I think black man is getting a lot better. Their situation improved dramatically over the last 25, 30 years. Okay? Now you see a black man, you don't think about he going to steal. You do not think right now that much. You don't wish to think about it.
Okay.
All right.
Next. Next. Right with Evershot. Remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, when you're ready, bro.
One each according to their ability, and two each according to their need. That's a distributive principle which you will find was lived out by the Christians in the book of Acts, in the Christian Bible, in the New Testament of the Christian Bible, the second and fourth chapters of Acts. Everybody lived together, and they distributed according to people's need. Now, the wage system under capitalist rule in a capitalist society does not distribute according to need. It distributes grudgingly according to how much you can get away with. And that's the problem. How do we have so unequal a society economically? Well, the royal labor position of the American worker after World War II, because this was the industrial heartland of the world, is gone. Capital has exported to other markets and is exploiting other markets. And the reinvestment in capital in the United States. There is reinvestment. You know, money is coming from Europe, from all over the world to the United States because the capitalist markets are on a very shaky basis all over the world, and they seem to be much steadier politically here because you get the best government money can buy right here in the USA. Yeah. And, well, let's see. What can we say? To each according to their need. You know, farm workers work harder than most workers, really. You know, stoop labor in hot, dirty, dusty fields with no facilities for going to the washroom. There's no washroom.
Yeah.
Until the workers get organized enough to demand something like that. And yet, even with capitalist unions, what's happening to the cost of the produce? Well, the produce costs go up, and the value of their pay, everybody else's pay too, goes down. It's called inflation, and it's endemic in the capitalist markets of the world.
Did I give you a check?
You may be striking for $15 an hour for Chicago McDonald's workers, but McDonald's workers, you know, there is a minimum wage, a legal minimum wage of, what is it, $8.25 an hour.
This is my fullest.
But, you know, you can't live on $8.25 an hour very well. You probably not at all. All right.
Your time's up, Ronald.
Thomas Gandhi began the nonviolence, not first in South Africa and then in Ahmedabad, where he was the leader of a textile strike.
Yeah, okay. Well, it's, we gotta let the other speakers have a chance, bro.
Whenever our family celebrates May Day, and you know, May Day is born here in Chicago, so we should really acknowledge that the farm workers of the world are very beloved, very respected, and very thanked by all of us in Chicago. It says, written by Emma Lazarus at the Statue of Liberty, "Give us your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless tempest-tossed, to we lift our lamps beside the golden door." And, you know, I think about that on May Day. My great-grandfather, John Mazur, came from Eastern Europe to Chicago in 1901. He was looking for a job. Could have easily become a farm worker, but he happened to become a railroad worker on the south side of Chicago, which was the reason he could make a living, raise my grandmother. It's a dangerous job. A lot of times he would ask one of his colleagues, "Where's so-and-so? He wasn't here today, or he wasn't here this week." And one of his colleagues would say to my great-grandfather, John Mazur, and he died. That was just the reality of that workplace at that time. We've transitioned under a lot of people. Ronald Reagan comes to mind, in my mind a lot, but a lot of people, from a manufacturing society to a service society. And I'm glad you said that, because we should always remember that the beauty of any industrialized country is its manufacturing base, not its service sector. When we start to put our whole entire mindset that it's, you know, it's a be-all and end-all philosophy of service, we stop becoming our best. And we can't exist in the 21st century when we think that that's a solution. Another thing that I think about on May Day and some of the ideas that go through my mind is how, yes, we are a nation where there's a lot of people, whether it's Paul Ryan or Mitt Romney or the Koch brothers or Sheldon Adelson, very afraid of genuine participatory democracy. They're not afraid, although they pretend to, that we're becoming a totalitarian communist country. What they're really saying when they're fear-mongering, they're afraid of us becoming a democratic socialist society like Iceland, like Norway, like Finland, like Sweden, like Denmark, like Canada, like Japan. That's what they're really afraid of, because you can't stop that. Once participatory democracy enables workers to be the prime beneficiaries of their work, what takes over is we the peopleism. What takes over is all-inclusivism, which Emma Lazarus was really right on the mark with that famous phrase that we still are beloved all over the world for, Statue of Liberty welcoming all. And we don't close our doors, we open them, because that's who we are naturally as human beings. We definitely have some challenges ahead of us. We're a nation that we've lost our way, and we need to now listen to new voices and new ideas. We need to listen to those who work on the land. We need to listen to the working classes. Another quote that I always love to think about, when I think about and just remembering who we really are and keeping our course, is by John Lennon. He says, I think this is very appropriate for the farm workers, "We've got this gift of love, but love is like a precious plant. You can't just accept it and leave it and just think it's going to get on by itself. You've got to keep on watering it. You've got to really look after it and nurture it." I just like to remind myself and everybody here, we have to keep on nurturing new ideas and true participatory democracy, no matter where that leads, because I think we'd be surprised some beautiful things that happen if we continue to just keep on nurturing new ideas. So.
As far as new ideas, I think there are some old ideas that are still relevant in America. Farm workers have been used in America. I didn't see the film, but maybe you talked about the 50's and braceros movement program that brought Mexicans to America to do the farm work, then sent them back to Mexico.
Yes, sir.
So this has been going on forever. One thing I want to talk about is the poor, homeless people and the poor, starving people on the corner that don't work. You know, there used to be white people that were in lines in the 30s and 40s, let's say the 30s. There were lines and lines of hundreds of white people in bread lines, apple lines. They were hungry, they were out of work. And these people were not called bums. They were not called lazy. They were not called stupid. They were not called uneducated. What they were was they were sympathetic. Oh, those poor people, those poor white people. We got to get them jobs. We got to fill their stomach. We got to help their kids grow up because they're white. Thanks.
All right,
brother.
All right.
So now you got brown and black people, and they're bums, they're no good, and they're uneducated, they're stupid. Now there's a disconnect. There's a philosophy missing there. And I think they call me a liberal, call me a bleeding heart liberal. But I see poor white people out and uneducated and without work, and their kids are hungry, and they don't have shoes, and there's something missing. Thanks.
First of all, I'd like to thank the Munozes for coming out and today and sharing their story with us. I'm old enough to remember when my mother decided not to buy grapes at the supermarket for the very reasons that we talked about. I would, however, take exception to some other things that have been said here tonight. First of all, I do not believe that any person has it so constructed in their genes as to exploit other people. And I take considerable offense at that kind of racist remark. That's number one. Number two, regarding the advocacy that was made of land tonight, I will simply say this. This is a joke that some of you have heard me crack here before, but apparently it bears repeating. A long time ago, there was a conference in Moscow, and somebody stood up there, and there was all the big shots were there. Khrushchev was there, all the big shots. And somebody stood up and said, Mr. Chairman, Comrade Chairman, what is the difference between capitalism and communism? And the chairman said, Comrade, I'm glad you asked that question. It's a very useful question. It's a very important question. Under capitalism, man exploits man. And under communism, it's the other way around. Thank you.
Got my book.
Yeah, I would also like to thank the Munoz. It's good to meet people who were actually there. I remember these movements myself, and I don't think I was ever bought any grapes anyway, but so I don't know if I participated in the boycott, but we enjoyed hearing your story. And if I have time, I'm going to talk about a different kind of a boycott here. Unions are becoming somewhat unpopular with the general voting public. We've seen that in Wisconsin, where Scott Walker was elected. He was elected on an anti-union kind of a platform, and he survived a recall on the same basis, even though the union people managed to get a million signatures and one of the biggest protests we've ever seen. Nonetheless, Scott Walker was reelected. Now we've got Bruce Rauner here in Illinois. And a lot of his reasoning, or a lot of his reason for succeeding, is being anti-union. And I think I know why this is occurring, and I think education will help solve the problem. I think what Scott Walker used is the fact that the average pension for a municipal worker of any sort, it varies, of course, from place to place and the type of job and so forth. Somewhere between $30,000 and $39,000 a year. Some are more, some are a little less, but somewhere in that range. The average Social Security recipient gets something like $12,000 a year. So when people hear these numbers, they say, hey, what's going on here? These municipal workers are raping us, they're robbing us. We got to stop this. We got to get a guy like Scott Walker in there to hold us down. Well, but the fact is, if you go further in the analysis, it's easy to see why municipal pensions pay more. First of all, Social Security people pay in 15.3%, including Social Security, or including healthcare, excuse me, into Social Security. The average municipal worker pays in somewhere around 21%, about 50% more. Now, over 30 or 40 years, that's going to grow quite a bit more. The other thing is, and this will maybe rankle the socialists here, but the Social Security money is invested in T-bills, about the lowest form of interest there is. Municipal pensions are, to a large extent, invested in, God forbid, the stock market. And at the end of 30 or 40 years, where is there going to be more money? That's why municipal workers are one of the main reasons they do better. And if people knew this, they wouldn't be quite so resentful of municipal workers. And the problem, the pension problem is caused more by the fact that the money wasn't set aside by the politicians, not so much that the pensions are way out of line. Now, and to a kind of related topic where a boycott may be appropriate. Over the years, I've been a bit of a misogynist, I'll admit that. I've had some women in my life, personal and business environments, that could be a real pain in the ass, okay? Nonetheless, I staunchly support a woman's right not to be raped, okay? Apparently, the NFL and the NCAA disagrees with me. They don't care. If some poor little woman who is unknown gets raped by a football star or any other kind of a star, they are going to try and sweep it under the rug as much as they can. We've seen this so many times before. Now, it's probably obvious that I'm referring now to James Winston of Florida State, who was the number one draft pick this year, and he was the Heisman Trophy winner a few years ago. They just could not wait to give him the Heisman Trophy. In his case, the true villains perhaps are not even him so much, although he committed the rape, as the cops who attempted to intimidate Erica Kinsman, the lady who was raped, and get her not to press charges and to drop it, and they delayed it. Her rape test wasn't even checked for 10 months. Okay, there was a DNA test, etc., etc. And the DA in Florida, Tallahassee, who said, "We don't have enough evidence to charge him, so we're going to drop charges." He dropped charges 2 or 3 days before the Heisman election, just by coincidence. So what we really have here, though, is not so much an issue of sexual assault, but what we've been talking about all evening, and that is the elites versus the common people, the wealthy versus the rest of us. Erica Kinsman is obviously an average person, not having any special privilege, whereas in fact James Winston does. So it's an elite. It's an elite issue. Are you in favor of rape?
What?
Are you in favor of rape?
Yeah, but your time's up.
I see. Well, I am going to finish, okay?
Okay.
Here's where we can play.
Where you at? I went outside.
No. Hey, keep.
I can't find the guy. Where you at?
Who? Who's he looking for?
I went outside.
Okay, we need to wrap it up.
All right, here's what those
here?
Small
what
people
outside?
Here can do.
No. What you going to go outside with me?
Let's go.
No.
Hey. Don't worry about it, Todd. Relax a minute. Okay, here's what we can do. Okay.
Ernie, we need to wrap it up now. Okay, this is not.
I'm going to wrap it up, Don.
Okay.
Do you mind?
Yeah.
Do you mind?
Yes, I do mind.
Well, I'm going to wrap it up. Okay. Here's what we can do. We can watch these football games if we enjoy them. We don't have to boycott the football games. But when it comes to the products, note the products that are being advertised by a competitor's product. And if you really want to go the whole route, get somebody to take a picture of you carrying the competitor's product out of the store, send that picture with a short note to the products that are being advertised. This might get a little bit of attention. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Ernie.
All right.
Here we go.
All right.
I have a rebuttal to give. but I think I also have a short 4-minute YouTube clip of me at a previous college of complexes that says it much better than I can articulate tonight. The clip is called, "Yes, Charlie, I Like Capitalism." It's only 4 minutes, so well within my time. For 300 years, and even now, thanks to the joys of the internet, I was able to deliver a real rehearsed, real regulated rebuttal from about 4 years ago to now. Thank you very much, and let's get our next speaker, a rebutter, up here.
Okay. Was that Eugene inside?
Yes, on the left.
Gene, was that you on the left?
Yeah.
I saw you on the left over there.
And I'm still within 5 minutes.
No. Who's that on the left?
That's Gene.
You're going 5 minutes, Tim?
Yeah, let me get the...
Start the...
We're going to get right back.
Get ready.
Okay, and we'll go.
I'd like to thank our speakers tonight for making the trip out here and giving us a first-person account of what many people are calling the economic war on the middle class in America. The middle class is solidly under attack since Ronald Reagan was installed in the White House in 1980. We've talked about that before, and it's not in debate. What can be done is spelled out in this book, Unprecedented: Can Civilization Survive the CO2 Crisis? The book is filled with examples of people providing better jobs, better living wages for farmers, workers, people across the spectrum, changing the way we use energy, oil. We need a massive transformation. And that can only come about if, as he said, there's a chapter in there that those of you that may be familiar with some Bible quotations, there's churches involved now saying it's our religious duty to stand up and stop the practice of companies, fossil fuel companies, who are destroying the planet. It's just that simple. And the particular question I've been wrestling with for some time, I've been a member here coming to the college since 2007, I think it was, shortly after it went non-smoking. I'm allergic to cigarette smoke, so I can't have dinner or breathe in an area where there's a lot of secondhand smoke. Now that the laws make it easier for all of us to breathe, like any of you, I can eat, have dinner, lunch in a restaurant, almost anywhere. At the college here, we have a slogan, the playground for people that think. It doesn't say the playground for people that want to promote criminally insane propaganda. As far as I know, we have never had a scheduled speaker to talk about the benefits of the pedophile priests, benefits of child abuse. These things are morally reprehensible, and I don't think you could have a debate with two people talking about the pros and cons of sexually abusing young children. The guy talking about the benefits would look like a criminally insane person. There's a lot of sides, a lot of issues. There are not two sides to debate. The facts are well known. And when what I've been wrestling with, Mike Foley and I, Mike has had an issue with, if somebody has a difference of opinion, you don't want to call them a liar. But what's different? When somebody stands up and intentionally tells you something that's false, and they know it's false, like the tobacco executives testifying before Congress with their right arms up in 1994, testifying under oath that we see no evidence that secondhand smoke is harmful. We see no evidence that nicotine's addictive. When their own internal report showed 30 years ago they were in the business of selling an addicting drug. When somebody knowingly tells you something that is so far out there that it's in the realm of flat earth ignorance, it's a bald-faced lie. Now, I spoke about our speaker 2 weeks ago, John Kunch. I wouldn't call him a liar, per se. What I would say is, I would like to know why he is telling us lies. Does he actually believe that stuff that's been proven false by thousands of scientists all over the world? Well, the material he gave us was knowingly false. Does he believe it? Or is he intentionally lying to us to create doubt? I think when people are intentionally lying to you and just burying you in criminally insane bullshit, it's incumbent on us to stand up and say, that's wrong, that's a lie. No. Like we have to stand up and say, no, that boy didn't fall off his skateboard and die after he was put in a police van. The police beat him to death. We, and African-American people around the country are standing up and saying, it's time to put an end to this. And that's what they're doing in Baltimore right now. So in 2 weeks, we're going to explore another subject that some of you don't want to think about, but is steeped in reality, is the myth that we're all living under on the myth of 9/11. So one thing I would say, I take 15 seconds.
Yeah, all right.
I find it, give me 15 seconds.
Okay, go ahead.
It's offensive to have a moderator stand up and cut you off in mid-sentence when you only have 10 or 15 words left. I would like to call on the college to respect a person's last thought when they're trying to get a thought across. Don't just jump up and cut it off.
Yeah.
Okay. Does anybody else think that makes sense?
If let
it
me
makes
ask
sense,
you, no.
Raise your hand.
All right.
Thank you.
All right. No. Okay. Okay. Now, I want to ask.
I want to just say that the more time you take in rebuttal, the less time there is for other speakers. It's a zero-sum game.
I can't figure out.
So when you, hey, Tim, one full at a time, when you are, so when you decide you want to take an extra minute and 30 seconds like Ernie did, basically you're taking time away from other people who have as much of a right to speak as you do. Why do you think just because of what you have to say is more important than those other people? It isn't. No matter how much you might think of yourself, you don't have a right to take more time than others. Now, we agreed on 5 minutes. You come up here, you also agree on 5 minutes. When you take more than 5 minutes, you are breaking your agreement. You are breaking a promise that you are breaking a promise that you made to keep it to 5 minutes. All right? You are dishonoring the whole point of the College of Complexes. All right? And you're not being fair to the other people here, and you're not being fair to the other speakers. You're not being fair to the other people who are here, and you're not being fair to and you're not being fair to anybody here. All right, you know, I think that a lot of people, they come up here and they just want to hear their own voice. They want to get a chance to talk in public to an audience. And what I've seen over and over again here is that people just go on until somebody stops them, and some people seem to have this attitude that they have more of a right to talk than other people. Well, you don't, and so that's. That's pretty much all I have to say on that subject. Well, I guess I got a couple minutes. I just, one other thing I did want to mention. I don't know how many of you are aware of the significance of, I mean, the reason we have a speaker here on the subject of organized labor is because we just had May Day yesterday. How many of you know about the origins of May Day holiday and what it means? Okay, well, I see a few hands up. Now, how many of you know about the connection between Chicago and May Day? Okay, the same hands. Okay, great. For those of you who didn't raise your hand, I'll just tell you briefly that May Day actually started here because of Haymarket riots, where the workers were campaigning for a they were actually on strike, campaigning for an 8-hour day, you know, Chicago was one of the great industrial cities in those days, and in any case, it happened on May Day. Somebody, I don't remember all the details, but anyway, somebody, the police came and to break up the workers where they were having their rally in Haymarket Square, just west of downtown, and somebody threw a bomb, and some policemen were killed. And the policemen opened fire, turned into a big riot, and they ended up rounding up the ringleaders, what they considered the ringleaders. These guys were basically run through a kind of kangaroo court and sentenced to death, and ended up being hanged, except for one guy who committed suicide in his cell. Now, how many of you know about the connection between that there's a link between Haymarket and Chicago back then and the College of Complexes today? Anybody know about that? No one. Oh, wow. Well, I got another minute left, so I'll just tell you very briefly what it is. there's after the Haymarket thing, and by the way, the trial of the so-called Haymarket Marx became an international cause célèbre. It was known all over the world. That's how the May Day became the international labor holiday in every country except for the United States. But the widow of one of the so-called Haymarket Marx, one of the people that was hanged, was a man named Albert Parsons, one of the people convicted. His widow, Lucy Parsons, went on to found here in Chicago an organization called the Industrial Workers of the World, the IWW, which was founded in 1905. She was a co-founder along with Big Bill Haywood and some other people, and it happened right here in this city. One of the things that grew out of that was actually the Bughouse Square, which some of you may have heard of. It was the original free speech forum. And one of the people who was a regular at Bughouse Square was a guy named Slim Brundage, and he went on to found the College of Complexes. So that's it.
Speaker gets the last word. Speaker gets the last word.
Oh, well.
Yes. Speaker gets the last word.
Okay. Oh, this.
You know, folks, I can't make it any easier with the timer. You can see it, and it's up there. So, you get the last word.
Okay. Well, our speaker. Did you want to speak?
Yes.
Okay.
I'd like to say thank you very much for the opportunity to be with you all tonight. We've enjoyed it very much. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you. And that's all.
No, you're gonna be able to get that later.
Oh, he's not.
That's all, folks, and thanks for coming tonight.
Hey, not you.
His wife's.
Oh, I should be with you. I love you.